Okay, guys. Kamen Rider Deno Part 3 commentary.
It's time for the climax. The last climax. All the way to the very end.
Yeah.
Kind of.
The last third of Deno, I think, is pretty good.
Yeah, it's a strong finish. I think this is finally, like, one of the points where Kamen Rider is, like, finally hitting that point where that last stretch isn't a slog anymore. Yeah. Like, the last one that we watched where the last act wasn't a slog was it Blade? I think Blade was, like, kind of mesh, but...
Well, you were asleep for the most of the ending part of Blade anyway.
Well, that wasn't really my fault. Let's see. I know Kabuto, we were like... I was like, for that last act. Because of all the bullshit.
Fies. That's it. That's the only one.
Was it really?
Yep.
Huh. But yeah, I'm hoping this is the point, because like the overall narrative writing is getting much stronger. Like, it's really fun. Like as we're progressing through these shows,
yeah,
where you can see like in Kuga it was definitely Monster of the Week format, and Agito is definitely Monster of the Week format. Where even to the show's detriment, and then Ryuki also to the show's detriment. And you know, stuff like that, and it's just like now they're weaving the monster fights into the plots better, and they're also, and I think that's in part to the two episode arcs.
Yeah,
I think this is the first time they did just all of the basically all the monsters are two episode arcs.
Yeah, like for the most of them were.
I want to say the vast majority.
Yeah, it's like, I think there's only like two guys that weren't one episode.
Yeah, it was it's a pretty low amount. Like Kabuto was still mostly Monster of the Week. There were a couple of two-parters.
Oh man.
And then the one before that, before Kabuto, which one was before Kabuto? It wasn't Fies. Was it Blade?
I think maybe Blade.
God, I have a feeling. I honestly feel like I'm forgetting one of the series.
I mean, Hibiki was a two weaker every time.
Was it Hibiki into Kabuto or
Hibiki into Kabuto?
Yeah. Okay, so I was forgetting Hibiki. Yeah.
The only time it wasn't like a two-parter was the episode when they introduced Hibiki's red form or whatever.
Or whatever, yeah. Okay. Yeah. But yeah, so it's just cool to see like now the narrative writing is getting much, much stronger. So in this last act, I was actually more invested in the last third than I was throughout most of the show beforehand.
It's because they did the introduction of an actual villain as opposed to just the monster showing up every week.
Monster. Yeah, we have a focal. They introduced this character named Kai, who becomes the focal villain, and he can control / is the source of kind of the imagine.
From what nothing is actually said or explained. It's just things happen.
I think I can extrapolate like what the deal with Kai is, but I guess we'll get to that.
I think like, he's just the singularity point. That's the anchor for the time that the Imagines come from.
Yeah, and they've all possessed him. Like they, like with Rio, like what Ryotaro. Yeah.
Well, it wasn't until like the very end that they all were just like, get in,
everybody, get in here.
Yeah.
So Kai, I'm not really big on him because like he's not my favorite kind of character. To me, he's not interesting. He's just the mentally unhinged character, but not in like any sort of focused way. He's just sort of like, I'm mentally unhinged every time he opens his mouth, and it's just not a character I'm fond of.
Anyway. For the last third of the show, he gets introduced, and then we're spending time thwarting his plans to link to make the imagine future the
future of this world.
The future of this world.
That's basically the end goal.
Yeah, and to do that, he has to find somebody specific and kill them or something.
And get rid of them forever.
Yeah.
I still don't really understand, like, what the plan was on the hero side. Like, I don't...
The plan on the hero side... Is that
okay? Well, let's go like in order of like the reveals, like the reveal of like the whole memory loss thing, which was a really yeah. interesting like arc line.
Are you talking about the Zeroness cards specifically?
No, I was talking more about Ryotaro's like his missing memory.
Oh, Ryotaro apparently just misremembered the past and forgot about some things.
Yeah, the owner postulates, or it's like when Ryotaro says, oh, one day Sakurai-san just vanished. And then the owner comes in and he just says, well, that's from your perspective.
And seeing that you're the only person who remembers that, we just took your word for it.
Yep, so it's like we only have the one perspective to go on. So the owner says, it's entirely possible that your perspective is just wrong. And then we get, it's Christmas time, and the shop gets the package, right? And it's got the watch in it.
Yeah,
it's got another watch in it, just like the one that they got for Sakurai. And Ryotaro's just like, well, why did we get this? So they go to the shop to talk to the guy. And the guy was just like, oh yeah, sorry, I was supposed to send it out back in August, but I totally forgot. My bad. So, Ryotaro was just like, well, why did I do that? And he's just like, oh yeah, you came in, like, right after that one time you came in to get the watch for the guy or whatever, and you said you wanted it to be kept secret from your sister. And he's just like, well, why would I do that? And then everyone's just like, huh, there was no graduation going on, the marriage was supposed to take place in, like, February of that year or something.
No, it was supposed to take place after graduation.
Or it was supposed to take place after graduation, but it wasn't for the purpose of the graduation celebration.
Yeah.
He's going through the reasons he would buy the gift.
The timeline was that, like... The wedding was supposed to take place after the graduation.
No, the wedding is supposed to take place in February, way before the graduation.
No, it's supposed to take place after the grad.
The wedding?
They specifically talk about how the wedding was supposed to take place after the graduation.
Was it?
Yes. And then this is literally to throw you for a loop in the reveal that the wedding took place before the graduation.
That, oh, okay, that was it. I was misremembering the past. Good thing we had.
Yeah, and it wasn't until they start figuring out all these, they start, like, getting all the, they get breadcrumbed the answers, that one of the times Ryotaro's like, oh, wait, now I remember, it's like, I remember now, the wedding happened before graduation, and then...
Yeah, it was like, he was just... So they're going down, like, the list. He's just like, well, why would I buy a gift? There's nothing going on. There were no birthdays or anything like that going on. For those of you who can do...
Literally, Scott figured this out by going down process of elimination of them saying what events that the things weren't for. He was like, well, the only other big thing I have left is childbirth.
also, if you do a little bit of mathematics... August is like about 8 months after December, and the only time you'd figure out a pregnancy, like for sure-sies, is like a month after the conception when the woman misses her period.
Yeah.
So it's entirely. So. Nae-san was pregnant!
Yeah!
Pregnant before they got married. Just saying!
No, they actually. The timeline they gave is that they were married before. Or they were married before the pregnancy.
No, because the wedding was supposed to happen in that year, in that February, before that August.
No, that's the that well that's the thing. That's the missed remember that's the missed remembered.
No, because then the graduation would happen like after, the, in like
the one of the things May. Is like one of the things that they're talking about when they're talking about the pregnancy is like okay or when he gets all of his memories back, he goes, I remember now. It's like they didn't get married after they weren't like it wasn't to get married after graduation, they got married before. And then the pregnancy came up after that.
Oh, you know what? I'm forgetting that Japanese school years are on a different schedule. So graduation is like near the end of the year, isn't it? Or something?
I don't know, honestly.
But yeah, that was the big reveal. Nae-san was pregnant. She was gonna have a babu.
Yeah, she's pregnant with a singularity point, which is
that's a pretty specific gender.
Yeah.
Well, what do you buy for a singularity point?
And Kai needed to eliminate,
get rid of it,
or needed to get rid of it to make his future
the true future.
The true future.
But and we can't let that happen.
Yeah, and he needed to get like. It's specifically he needs to get rid of it before it's born.
Otherwise, it's anchored in the timeline or some bullshit.
And after they figure all this out, Ryotaro makes extra leaps and figures out that
the singularity point that was going to be born to Nae-san.
Is Hannah.
Alright, you gotta help me here, please. Like, did I miss it, like, with my phone in my hand or something? Or did he just guess?
I think he guessed based on process of elimination of... There's three singularity points. I'm not my sister's child. That's the guy's from the future that he's trying to destroy my sister's child. So then there's one left whose future is gone right now.
I guess, but like in my mind, because of like Kai being from an alternate timeline future, I'm just like, what's stopping them from being a gerbillion singularity points or something? Like, I don't know. Maybe I'm overthinking it or underthinking it or whatever.
I think what it is the order, the sequence of events are Kai destroys the future. This causes Hannah's future to be destroyed, and because she's a singularity point and unaffected by it, she gets on the denliner, and because she gets on the denliner, she goes back in time and makes Ryotaro the Deno, and making a stable time loop. And then, or no, not even a single, it's,
you can't even call it a
stable time altercation of some,
you can't even call it a time loop, because like, I don't even remember them at the end of the show saying Hannah's going to be born, because like,
what they needed is, after they dealt with Kai, they needed Ryotaro to remember about Hannah, and then his memory would bring back her future.
Okay, I have a question, because they don't say it outright, but after time breaks down and gets rebuilt in the end, does Nae-san remember about Sakurai and all that stuff, like being married and having a, is going to have a child, or is like she
nope
So she's just gonna wake up pregnant?
What?
And gonna have the baby, the babu? Or am I, this
whole plan was forged before, or was forged under the assumption that Yuto doesn't use all the cards.
Oh.
But Sakurai was like, even with the jacked up time, I'm confident that my younger self is still gonna be in love with what's her name, and thus, even if he goes and makes his own future, it's just gonna work out anyway.
Man, I hope so, because that's a real fucked up timeline. I can't even understand the timeline, because Yuto keeps showing up. Like, young Yuto.
Yeah. He needs to, cool it and go back to his own time.
Like that time he died? All right.
Oh, no! I died! Oh, no! I'm dying!
Oh, hey, guys, I'm back. Literally, all right, so there's one scene where the Imagines go back in time and they murderize Sakurai Yuto in the past. Teenage Yuto.
Because he's not a singularity point, the present him dies.
No, he vanishes into the time gone. So then everyone's angsting about it, and then near the end of, is it that episode or the next one? It's like it's got to be the end of that episode, because it was so fast. He just walks back in, I have the Uranus cards. I can't be erased from time. And I'm just like, what? Then what? it's like the trade-off to having the Uranus cards as you use them, making people forget about you. Thus, eventually, through overuse, would erase you from time. While you have those cards, you cannot be erased from time until you use all the cards. I guess that's the trade-off. He's just like, the trade-off of my lonely and battle-ridden existence of making people forget about me is that I can't be erased from time. And it's just like, well, I mean, that would be a terrible trade-off if not for the fact that you're specifically fighting people who can erase you from time. But he shouldn't have disappeared in the first place, because Ryotaro was right there! Who remembered him? Because the piano guy!
Oh, man!
Am I not understanding the rules of this whole, memory deal? Am I not understanding? Because we can't say, oh, Ryotaro's memories don't count, even though he's a singularity point, because the entire plan of the heroes cruxes on Ryotaro's memories! So is it because it's a Yuto from the past?
I don't know! I just don't know!
That's probably...
The only problems that we had with the end were every time they were like, No, but this! They set up a bunch of rules at the start, and the end of the show seemed like literally just to break all of those rules.
Maybe if I were to read a comprehensive list of all the times the rules were relevant, maybe it would make more sense. But even watching the show from beginning to end, I'm kind of left with questions. But I'm willing to forgive all that, because the show's really entertaining anyway. Yeah. 90% of the characters are likable and memorable. The character
I'm going to remember the most, though, is Piano Man.
I'm going to be a super plebeian and say character I'm going to remember the most is fucking Momotaros. I'm with you. Momotaros is best boy.
Yeah, we have We came up with our listing of our favorite Imagines.
Yeah, mine's still Momotaro's at the top, easy. Mostly because he, like, it's a little unfair because Momotaro's gets, like, all the spotlight. Like he's basically Deno's base form. Like, he's got, like, Deno has, like, the form without any armor or anything. He's just, like the black bodysuit with the helmet and all that stuff. But, like,
This is the same thing as Kuga. When you're thinking of Kuga, you're not thinking of white bitch-ass Kuga. You're thinking of strong red Kuga.
Or Agito. You're thinking of, like, the gold Agito. Or like, the other form changers that I can't think of right now. Like, with O's. You're not thinking of, like, I don't know, any coherent, like, triple combo. Because I already know a little bit about O's, yeah. with the coins.
You're not thinking about combos, you're thinking of Tataba.
Yeah, you're thinking of Tataba.
Or if you're me, you're thinking of Super Tataba.
whatever. But yeah, so, like, Momotaros is, like, de facto Deno. Like, it's, like, he's the one who shows up, like, Deno, like, Ore Sanjo, all that good stuff. So Momotaros, yeah, gets, like, the vast amount of screen time and the vast amount of interaction with Ryotaro. Like, Ura, Kintaros, and Ryuta, they all, like, don't get a lot of screen time with Ryotaro. Like, not a lot. Not definitely nowhere near as much as Momo.
Yeah.
They do have some moments, which are pretty cool. Man, I still wish for that last, like, I'm gonna stay behind, like, with Kintaros. He, like, made all of the wipe away your tears with this. All right. So one of the near the end of the show, it's like, oh guys, we have to run through time.
Right after they figure out the mystery of everything, and they're like, oh, we just gotta protect our sister. Kai's like, master plan. Everybody attacks from all points of time at once.
And by all, we mean like three or four or something.
It's like, it's literally...
it's not
attack,
all.
Attack the past and the present at the same time.
Yeah, so they go back, they use the Deadliner and they go back. And then it's just, and then Kintaros, he pops out. They kind of break one of those rules where
I would say that they never actually established a rule that they can't get off the train.
You're right.
Every time we see them leave the train before, the train is
there
between time, and they'll just go possess Ryotaro.
You're right. I'm also tripping because of that time they got off of the train in the movie.
Yeah.
So I'm also tripping. But anyway, Kintaros gets off, and he grabs the Deno belt, and he goes into axe form, like, not possessing Ryotaro, and he's just like, I'll take care of all of this. And he starts fighting off the Imagine, and then he takes off the belt and hands it back to Ryotaro. He's just like, okay, now I have to do it in my normal form, because you have to take the belt.
Yeah.
So they're just like, but Kintaros, we can't leave you. And he's just like, oh, you have to. And he's just like, you're strong, Ryotaro, and they have, like, that moment. So they get all on the train, and they're just like, oh, kook, you know, bear, and all that stuff, and they're just like, and he's just like, my strength has made you laugh, and then all the monsters are like, what? And he's just like, sorry, I guess that didn't make a lot of sense. Let me say it again. My strength has made you cry.
Now he still says the wipe away your tears thing.
Because he says
one line that's clearly not directed at the monsters.
Yeah, then
he fixes his line when nobody's there for his line. He's like, you know what? I'm just gonna change it. It's you guys.
Yeah. I still, because it's like, as the train's going away, I really wish he had, like, summoned his cloud of tissues and said, Ryotaro, wipe away your tears! As he's, murdering all, because there was this one really, really specific shot, like, you know, with the camera work, where it's like, they're in a destroyed area or whatever, and as the train's, like, flying away back into the space between times, there's, like, a scene with all the rubble, and like through the hole in the I'm motioning my hands like people can see me.
Yeah.
But there's like the hole in the rubble and you can see Kentaro through it. And I'm just like, as he's waving his goodbyes, I wanted all of the monsters to start converging on him. That didn't happen, but when he turns around, there's still like the wave of monsters.
They actually all still jump him at the end.
Yeah. But it was like I wanted it during that scene because But it was still a really good scene. I'm just like, oh, do they all get to do that? And it's just like, well, him and Urataras get to do that. Urataras gets to do his, like, oh, I lied about lying deal.
Yeah, Urataras gets a whole thing where he's like,
oh, I betrayed you.
Some imagine jump on the train, they put a bomb on it, they kick the good guys off, and then Urataras talks about stealing or taking the train and using it. So he's like, let's go attack the guys.
Urataras pretends to betray the Denliner crew, and they're just like, Urataras, was it all a lie? And he's just like, yeah, you know me, I'm a liar, guys.
And then he double lies.
And then he does the, oh, I lied about lying, I didn't actually betray anyone.
And, like the best part is, like, Ryotaro spends the entire time going like, yeah, I knew this was gonna happen. Like,
Ryotaro is just like, I'm pretty sure this is what's happening. I mean, I'm kind of like, because like, Ryotaro's not a dumb boy. He's a good boy.
Yeah.
He's not dumb. He's not super smart, but he's not a dummy.
Yeah. And then
Ryotaro's very what's the word I'm looking for? He's very perceptive.
Yeah.
He's aware of his faults and the things that go on around him.
Yeah. And then they do the same thing. They fuck. Everybody gets on the train. Urataros henshins with the belt, beats the monsters, throws the belt back, and then he goes on to fight more monsters.
Yeah, it's pretty great. Ryuta doesn't get to do that because he's like, sad that all of his friends are dying, but not really dying.
Like all we get is a Momotaros fighting a bunch of monsters, then Ryutaros hanging out with Ryotaro, and then Ryotaro saves Ryotaro from a bunch of collapsing rubble.
Yeah, it's still a really strong ending, especially like at the end. It's like, oh, we gotta fight the big final boss monster guy.
Yeah, the final boss monster is Kai's actual imagine, which is another Taro looking fucking monster.
Yeah. He looks like a big fucking jerkass.
Yeah,
and he's got a big death scythe.
Yeah, and he's gray. It doesn't have any color.
Oh yeah, because he's dead.
Yeah, and so they have the huge destroyed future fight
where everything is. They go back to the destroyed parts of Japan where they like to film in.
Yeah, during the fight. The train shows back up and drops off Urataras and Kintaras.
Oh, yeah.
They all look at Naomi and she goes, well, I figured since Manager-san's not here, I can do whatever I want with the time train.
She's just like, well, I mean, like, this is the only time specifically where they, like, break some rules.
But and it's all when the guy who tells you not to break them isn't there.
Yeah. Like, there's, like, the thing is, there's nothing preventing you from breaking the rules except for, like, the repercussions of bureaucratic superiors.
Yeah.
Essentially. There's nothing, like, nebulous or whatever about the universe that would prevent you from fucking with time.
It's they fuck with time multiple times, and it's like, the manager has always been like, look, let me go check on this. Okay, nothing actually bad changed.
Nothing major. You're only allowed, not allowed, but it's only not a big deal if it's not a big deal of what you changed. Like, oh, this kid's mom still died, but he got to talk with her at the end.
Yeah, and then
so nothing major changed. Or this guy made it to the job interview, but he didn't get it. So
yeah,
nothing major.
They start the huge good guy versus bad guy knockout brawl.
Oh, it's great.
Yeah, and then I was like, man, this scene could be greater if only one more person were here. Hannah runs up to a fucking monster to swing a pipe at it, does no damage, which makes no sense because she's punched She's punched people through trains!
No, that was teenage Hannah. This is Babu child 10-year-old.
Still makes no sense because she can gut punch and imagine and make them fall to their knees. And then when the imagine turns around to kill her, fucking Siegfried jumps out and
he's like, I am here, and I'm just like...
It's like, don't worry, Hime-sama, I will protect you, for I have been at the top.
And I'm just like, yo.
And then...
and he gets to do the head, like, I really do like the belt sound for wing form. It's really nice. Everyone gets to henshin. Everyone gets to work together to fight. Because, and then...
No, wait, Siegfried's the only one who doesn't henshin in that scene.
No, he goes into wing form.
No, because everybody henshins, but I... Everybody, the base ones henshin.
Oh yeah, they all swap out as they're fighting the monster.
Yeah, there's one where
I promise you Siegfried goes into wing
form. Ryutaros goes to henshin, and then Ryutaros cuts him off.
Well, whatever. I do know Sig shows up, and he does henshin. Like, he goes into wing form. Because they play the piano, you know, his belt thingo track. Trust me, he goes into wing form. Because I really wanted Climax wing form, but apparently I don't get that until Decade or something.
After Decade.
Whatever. I don't get that yet.
Anyway, so then as they're all fighting, they do this huge, awesome, like, all the warriors finisher.
Oh, okay, so, no, what happens is Momotaros is, like, you know, he gets, like, isn't this, like, everyone's got a belt? Yeah, everyone has a belt in that scene.
No. It's not. Yes. I promise you it's not.
No, I'm pretty sure...
What it is Momotaros goes... Hisatsu, final version,
final version.
And then he swings once, and then Kintaros catches it, kills a bunch of guys, and then swings it back at the monster. Then Ryutaros catches it, swings it around, throws it back at the monster. Then Ryutaros catches it with his gun, shoots it, and Sieg deflects it as it passes him. And it hits the monster, and then...
No, you're forgetting.
Oh, yeah!
and then it goes over to Yuto, who's back in Vega form, full-on Vega form. And he... Because apparently Deneb had, like, one last card or something.
There's one last yellow card.
Yeah, one last of the Vega cards. And he catches it, and he's a part of the Hisatsu final version.
Yeah, and then he shoots it, and then Momotaros catches it, and then does the slash.
It was everything I wanted out of a true All Warriors finisher.
Yeah, and then they do a fake out all the Imagine are gone thing.
But then they're not.
Because they're doing a funny scene where they're all crowded like behind a fucking hill. Like, oh man, we. Maybe we should come out and tell him, like, we missed our chance. But and then
it's really embarrassing.
And then they all start fighting, and then that's when they get found out.
It's good. It's really good. Most importantly, I think what Deno does really, really well is, like, the character interactions. Like, There are some, like, flat characters. Like, two of the characters I don't particularly like, mostly because they're just, like, just there, is, like, those two guys for the coffee shop.
Yeah.
The reporter guy and the monk, or whatever. I never really liked them. You should have kept
the bit of the change timeline where instead it was two girls gushing over her instead of fucking...
Oh, Nei-sama! It's like, wait, what? Yeah, that time when Yuto was gone.
When Yuto was erased, the timeline changed, and instead of guys gushing over her, it was a bunch of girls.
And then the monk was married or
had a child.
Or had a child, and then the reporter guy had bitches flocking to him.
Even though he already had bitches flocking to him. I went to say that as, like, that's the change timeline. Like, no, he was already doing that.
Yeah, it's like, I don't... It's like... I don't understand what, like, the process was, but it's just, like, whatever, change timeline, doesn't really matter. And then it was all fixed by the end of the episode anyway, so it didn't matter.
Yeah. I mean, one thing we forgot to mention is that, because they had, at one point, finger quote, like, ran out of yellow cards, they introduced the red cards
for Yuto,
which let him go into climax form. Or no,
it's not called climax form. It's I forget what it's called.
I think it's called zero form.
Is it?
I think it is.
Zero form. But he turns red instead of green, and Deneb turns into a gun instead of him just having a sword.
Yeah. Well, and he still has the sword. He just doesn't use it because he uses the Deneb gun. Because there's, like, two fights where he actually uses the sword.
Does he? I don't remember. One
of the fights is against the line guy where Sakurai shows up in Henshin's.
Oh, yeah, because when they go back to the past, where Sakurai is still Zeroness before he gave it to his past self.
Yeah.
And then Sakurai doesn't have to take care of his kid because he doesn't exist anymore.
Oh, man. And then
ain't gotta raise your kid if you don't exist.
after the finale, there's two more specials. There's Climax Deka, which is just them being time police after they've already saved the day.
And then Akiba basically, like, preview.
Yeah, Kiba shows up.
Kiba just shows up.
It's because the Fangire show up. They have a mixed group of Imagine and
Fangers
and Fangires, and they because the Fangires are there, Kiva shows up, and then
he literally just shows up.
Yeah, they have a team up.
It's that bit. I want to talk about it because I literally jizzed. Okay. So
this is a really good moment.
All right. So they're fighting, like, Nega Taros. He's like a black Momotaros.
But and he has a Nega Denliner too.
Yeah, he has the Nega Liner. I don't know what it's called. I'm just gonna pretend to call it the Nega Liner. And it's like that time I guessed drag blacker from Ryuki. I was like, I was joking, guys. I was like, oh, it's drag blacker because it's drag redder but black. And then we see the card says drag black. But yeah, so he's got his, like, Nega liner. So they're fighting Nega Taros, and it's Ryotaro and Yuto, because Yuto's there, obviously. And then Kiva shows up to help them, and then Negataros is just like, oh, you can't stop me if I'm in between time, and he jumps onto his train. So they follow him on the Denliner and the Zero Liner into, you know, the alternate world, into the reality.
They start the train fight, or the train fighting sequence.
Yeah, it's like the big CG train fighting sequence. It's actually pretty cool.
The Nega Liner does everything the Denliner does, except they just swap out what's firing the things with giant Imagine.
Yeah, giant Imagine monsters, which, like, was a really weird thing. I was like, why would they do this? Is this, like, because Hibiki was a thing for 5 minutes, and it's just like, I don't know. It never made sense, and it never really meant anything, but whatever. It didn't matter.
Anyway,
really.
the Nega Liner beats the Denliner and the Zero Liner.
It starts beating them up, and then Negataros is just like, ah ha ha, I'm stronger than you, and all that stuff. He starts charging up his final laser, and right before I say, I swear to God, if Kiva shows up, he fires the laser, and then a huge sandstorm
just blocks the.
And then it's Kiva who summons his noble phantasm, Castle Doran, like he's a Fate character or something. And it's just a giant turtle castle thing that connects to the Den and Zero Liners. And they beat the Nega Liner. And I'm just like, what is happening? It's great because obviously I've been on a huge Fate kick recently, and it's just like, what's he gonna do? Summon his noble phantasm in the space between time? And he just does. Kiba wasn't even there. Like, he watches Zirinus and Deno just go onto their trains and jump through time. And then it's just like, how did Kiba get there?
He just jumped in after them.
I fucking
and
guess.
Before the tracks went fully into the time portal, he just jumped in.
I fucking guess, okay, man. Like,
oh man.
That just summons his reality marble.
So good.
It's so good. I really hope he does it in Kiba. Don't tell me. Don't tell me yet. We haven't started it yet.
So then the final movie that introduces
Saraba Deno.
Yeah, it introduces Cho Deno. It's supposed to mark the passing of the Deno
torch
to the new Deno, even though old Deno still gets to stay.
Even though it's not really him, it's just another actor who plays him.
Oh, it's so dumb.
I still say, I literally heard about all this, I'm just like, why didn't they just get an older actor and pretend it was an older Ryotaro instead of, like, create a bullshit, this is younger Ryotaro, he's younger and hipper, and still Deno, and she's like, well, why?
There's, like Ryotaro shouldn't even have been there, shouldn't even still be in the...
Yeah, but I'm just saying, like, even if he's still gonna be there, why not just, like, get someone a little bit older? It doesn't even have to be, like, super... And just introduce him as, like, this is Ryotaro, but with more experience, and he's a little bit cooler or something.
This is... No, it could have been the older Ryotaro, where it's like, this is, this is Dad Ryotaro.
Yeah, this is like, oh, I've got a three-year-old now, but I gotta protect time.
I have a three-year-old now, but my fucking son, but my future son's being a real chode.
Future grandson.
Yeah, future grandson's being a real chode.
Yeah, he's kind of a fucking chode.
They could have just had the old man, Ryotaro, replace the train manager.
No, he's got to stay in his time to be a singularity point, though. Like, he's got to stay in his time.
No, he's retired from being the singularity point, because his grandson's being the singularity point.
No, it's like, no, wait, is
his grandson is a singularity point.
Oh, I didn't know that.
It's because shenanigans happen in another movie that we can't watch for, like, another year. And it's what drives home that he's a fucking singularity point.
Oh, okay, well.
But there's a new Imagine named Teddy introduced, who's just, instead of being one of Cho Deno's forms, he just becomes a sword.
And he's got this gimmick of how many seconds. Alright, I'll kill you in 10 seconds.
Yeah.
And then he counts down from 10 seconds and he kills you. And the bad guy is just like, oh, the countdown, like, he fails to kill the big bad guy of the movie, and he's just like, oh... Well, it's past zero, and you didn't kill me. I guess it's my turn.
No, it's not that. It's not that it passes zero. He knocks down Cho Deno before the countdown can be finished, and then he just picks up the countdown.
Yeah. Because as he starts, so Cho Deno starts count. I don't even think they call him Cho Deno. But anyway,
it's not going to be until after this that they call him it.
Da 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 da. Yeah. So Cho Deno, he does his countdown shtick, and he gets to, like, I don't know, five, I guess? It's like five or four or something like that. And yeah. Then the final boss is just like 3, 2, 1, 0. Like, you know, he actually counts out the full seconds. Like, he's a WWE or fight, referee counting it down, and he's just like 0. He's like, oh, you didn't beat me. I guess it's my turn now. And he fucking whoops Cho Deno's ass.
Yeah, and then we get a whole, like, ancient or fucking
elephants.
We get this whole dumb elephant thing, elephant mystery, and then
so for some reason we decided to have, like, a plot line where there's a Nae-san in the past who meets a Sakurai-san in the past. And like, why would you do this? We don't need this.
The bad guy's plan was to
kill everyone alive and revive everyone dead.
By having Ryotaro kill his own ancestor, which would cause the flip.
Which would cause literal time to fucking bend out of shit.
Yeah.
And, like, whatever. whatever. The bad guy was alright for the movie. Like, he had, like, a legit... Like, he's actually got, like, a pretty cool backstory. Like, his sister died... I forget why his sister died. Was him, it, like, a war?
I wasn't paying attention to whenever... to the flashbacks, honestly.
I don't remember...
I just think it's him and his sister are dead, and he just wants to bring back his sister.
Yeah, no. It's his sister died, and then he lived with the regret of, like, her dying, and then, like, after he... And then, like, that anger and resentment carried him for the rest of forever.
No, there was a spider.
Yeah, I saw it.
I'm just letting them know, because, like, the sudden stopped talking, and then this whack.
A thumb. Yeah, we're all just dead now.
That's how time stop work, doesn't it?
No, but we don't have time. I'll never forgive that scene now. Now that I'm, like, older and wiser. We have to save him. No, we don't have time. looks down.
Sir, you're literally just in hyperform.
Kamento, we have to save your evil twin.
No, it's like, I like how it got worse after the fact for you, because you're like, they have the time belts. I was like, no, Scott, it's worse because Kamento can go back in time.
Just looks down at time stopping belt. No, we don't have time, but Tendo, we have the... No, we don't have time, but clock... No, we don't have time. No, we don't have time.
Oh, man.
All right. But back to Deno. Like, I was saying, the bad guy had a pretty decent backstory. Like, you can kind of, like, get where he's going. Like, his sister died, and all that anger and resentment just carried him through to the afterlife, where he takes over the Phantom Train from Final Fantasy VI. They don't suplex it, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But he takes over the fucking Hades Train of the Dead, and, he's doing all the spooky, scary skeleton shit. And he's gonna invert time and whatever to, like, bring all the dead back to life. And he's just like, hey, all you dead guys, if you fight with me, I'm gonna bring you back to life. And they're just like, yeah, fucking deal.
Yeah.
He's like, all you have to do is murder this entire village and you can come back to life.
They have a moment where, like, leading up to the final fight, Cho Deno is about to, like, go off because he's the only one around who's gonna hench in to an extent.
Yeah.
And then they're like, then Momotaros is like, well, if you're taking over the era, at least let us have one final fight.
Yeah.
And then so then they have the fight against the Army of the Damned.
Is it this movie where the owner's just like, oh, I have extra passes so everyone can henshin or something like that?
It's a little bit after this.
Yeah.
They do the whole, like, oh, by the way, we forgot to mention a huge plot point in the movie is that they kidnapped Ryotaro.
Yeah.
And the one of the Imagine possesses him and just keeps turning into skull form.
It's pretty great.
So then they have the huge fight against the Army of the Damned and the possessed Ryotaro. They get Ryotaro back. And then they have the huge all the warriors moment where everybody gets to henshin and everybody's gonna fight Imagine.
Yeah, so it's like Ryotaro in Denliner form, and then, like, sword form, axe form, rod form, gun form.
What's this? Yuto shows up again. He goes into Zero form.
He goes into the Red Zero form, which was weird for me because we just came from the other movie where he was in his regular green form, or like his original green form.
He was in
Altair form. Yeah. Altair form.
Yeah. And
then
it's not until like the very. Oh yeah, Sig's there too.
And Sig was there. That's okay, maybe that's when he went into wing form, and that's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah.
Because we watched, like, all of it in, like, a day or whatever. So
yeah. Cho Deno shows up, like, immediately, or, like, and when they have to deal with the final guy for sure.
Yeah, and then he goes into Cho Deno form.
Yeah.
Cho Deno form.
And they saved the day, and then they finally learn that the reason why fucking what's his face?
Kotaro?
Kotaro badmouths.
It's because he's got a boring name or something.
It's his boring name and bad luck. Because apparently he has bad luck, even though
it never showed up in the movie, which was really
even when he says it doesn't show up, which is dumb.
Yeah, and then he meets his grandfather back in the future, and they walk down a pathway, and nothing bad happens, even though there's like a singularity of bad luck walking down the road.
You know, all the worst luck in time, all standing next to each other.
The two unluckiest people in all of time.
Yeah.
Deno's a lot of fun. Deno's, like, really enjoyable, especially because of, like, the Imagine. The only problems, like, that really arise from it is if you think about it too hard, and, like, that final, like, set of what's the plan here for the good guys, it's just... So, one thing I say is I really think it's just Kai should have been Nason's baby, because I feel like that would have been more, like... Of a deal breaker, because with Kai he was like, oh, I gotta find the other singularity point so I can whatever, and he's just like, oh, it's a baby that doesn't exist anymore or some bullshit, and he just kind of like has a moment where he breaks down, and I'm just like, and before I know the baby is Hana, because they don't reveal that until the very end, I'm just like, oh, the baby's him, and now he's just like, well, I'm gonna fucking erase time forever, and I'm just like, all right, just tell me the baby is Kai, and it's just like, oh, the baby's Hana. I'm just like, what the fuck? I maintain that the baby should have been Kai, because that would have been a way better moment. I don't know why they changed it, or not changed it. I don't know why they went with that, with Hana. Like, there's nothing wrong with Hana being the baby. It's just, I feel like it would have been way better if Kai was the baby. Because then that would have, like, been, like, more fucked up, you know? That's like, now I have to kill my nephew or something in order to, like... Whatever. No, nothing.
No, that would have been too much drama thrown on to like the very end of the show.
No, it would have been like it would. All right. Too much drama.
Literally, we have a character who needs like two or three episodes to deal with the regular drama, and then. Oh man.
Yeah, but then it's just.
And then you have to deal with the extra, like, double character drama where it's like, I have to murder my own son and I have to murder my own nephew or whatever.
No, yeah, because it would have been Yuto's son, future son, who's as old as him. Speaking of Yuto and how his power is basically derived off of people's memories from him, Deneb tries to go around making memories with people. He basically does the persona protagonist thing and create bonds with people in order to harvest their memories for power. Only it's Deneb, so he's a good boy, and he doesn't do it maliciously like that. But if you break it down, it's, hey, become my friends so I can use your memories of me to fight and kill.
Oh, man.
It's like, geez, Deneb.
I think it's just to create that larger buffer so that Sakurai doesn't get erased.
Yeah. No, it's definitely that. But it's like, but
No. It's not the no. He's not making the buffer for to prevent Sakurai from being erased. He's making the buffer for Yuto to prevent Yuto from being erased.
Yeah.
Because he likes Yuto more than he does Sakurai.
Yeah. A little bit.
I know this is weird because we're talking about the same person, but
yeah, we use Sakurai to reference the older version of the character, which is what all the characters in the show do, and Yuto is the teenage version that we see most of the time as Zirinus. As most of the characters refer to him.
Yeah.
He makes a girl accidentally fall in love with Yuto. And then, like...
They use that card immediately.
They use that card immediately, obviously, because, like, we have... Like, you want to talk about drama? How's about that? Some drama. Of course, that was, like, some bullshit whatever drama. And... There was, like, the really fucking obnoxious scene. Like, it's like, obviously, as soon as you see that she has feelings for Yuto, you know where the show's gonna go, that he's gonna use the card, and she's gonna lose her memories.
Because there's only one love for Yuto, and that's Nason.
Yeah. And, or they don't say that, but, like, whatever. And it's like, Before he uses the card, he gives it was like him or Deneb, I can't remember who, but or Deneb possessing Yuto is what I should say. But they give her, the girl, a scarf or something like that. And then after he fights the Imagine that had possessed her, and she loses her memories, she's just like, "Why do I have this scarf? Oh well." And she starts, you know, she's like a really like. Frolicky kind of person, like if that's like a really weird descriptor for someone, but if you understand what I'm talking about, she's just like a Genki girl, frolicky type. That's the only way I can describe her. Like she's a one off character essentially. So like there's no other ways I can really describe her. But she like frolics off, and the scarf gets caught on like a branch or something sticking out of the ground because they're on a beach. And then she stares at it for a second. She's just like, "Oh well," and goes off and leaves it there. I'm just like, I mean, it's still a scarf. I mean, whatever. We gotta have that, like, that final nail in the coffin as Yuto watches on as someone who he met gained memories of him and then immediately lost them. Intense feelings of attraction.
Yeah. Costume-wise, All the Imagine costumes, I think, are good, like, monster-wise.
I'm pretty sure, like, the... Like, it's... not a problem, but I have a slight... It's like that thing with, It's like that thing with Ryuki, where, like, the monster... Like, certain monsters are just different just because they have to, like, correspond to a writer. So like the or was it Ryuki? Or was it Blade?
Blade. The cards had had the symbols.
Yeah, but there is one where it's like these are the evil monsters, and these are the monsters that the writers harness for power.
Oh yeah, like, that's Ryuki.
It's Ryuki. And it's like, if you look at, you know, Deno, it's like, here's a monster Imagine. It's just like big, decked out, whatever. And it's like, here's an Imagine that a writer harnesses for power. And it's like a dude in spandex with a little bit of armor pieces and a mask and whatever. Yeah. like the only one who really breaks, like, Momotaro's is that. Like, he's really basic. I guess it has to reflect with, like, how people's imaginations shape them, and then it doesn't work because Ryuta is like super decked out in like the edgy, you know, long coat, fucking vampire slayer type deal, whatever outfit. And then Ura and Momo are like really basic. Kintaro's.
It's stable time loops because younger Ryotaro saw them, and then so when he had to come up with, or when his imagination came up with the image, he just remembered them, what they looked like.
It doesn't work.
The only person whose design is different is Kintaro's,
because he's got that big decked out coat.
Yeah,
it's great. Or that big decked out like fur line jacket is what it is. But no, the costume designs are cool. The rider designs are really cool. The only Deno form I wasn't really a big fan of, or well, two of them actually, and it's for kind of the same reason. It's Gun form and Climax form. Like Climax form is when they're all like jumbled onto each other, and the problem I have with Climax form is like it uses sword form as a base. So the chest armor piece is red. And then, like, you have the blue shoulder pad on one side for Urataros, and the yellow on the other side for Kintaros, and then fucking Ryutaros's big dumb dragon purple V slapped onto the red armor chest. But it's like, it's not just
the
purple.
The shoulders are also actually red.
Well, yeah, the shoulders are red, and then they have the yellow and blue like collapsed over
them. The masks,
right? The masks, but like then you have like Gun Form's mask just like strapped onto Climax Form's chest, and it's like yellow, white, purple on like the big red chest, and it looks it's like it's all the colors, and it looks kind of ugly to me.
Yeah,
like the mask splitting open for like the for the moment for the Climax Form's mask is like fine, whatever, but like it's that big
gaudy chest piece that I don't like. Denliner, or not Denliner, liner form is it's way better because it's just a sort of a variant.
It's just
a sword form variant.
I wouldn't even say a sword form variant. It's like, it's just a red version of that base form.
Of that super base
with
form.
With the fucking...
the spoiler.
The spoiler on top of it.
Yeah. And then, well, the mask has the three different colors, but it's like really subtle and light. And it's just like, yeah, no, this is a good design. And he's got the big dumb toy.
The big dumb greatsword.
The big dumb greatsword toy. Sold separately. Each Imagine sold separately.
Yeah.
Gotta sell toy.
It's also a gun.
Sometimes.
He shot it one time.
It's a gun once. Sold separately.
Yeah.
Gun attachment sold separately.
Oh, man.
1,200 yen. 12 bucks for that shit.
Oh, I wish it would be 12 bucks.
No, it's probably like 60 or some bullshit.
If I went to buy it, it'd probably be like 150.
God. But, Zeroness, his base form, Vega form, and his red form, Zero form, are all really cool. I kind of wish there was a Vega form for the red form, like with the cape and stuff. Even though I think Vega form is a little goofy with the Deneb face on the chest and the big, super, like, bulky, doesn't look very good. Like, Deneb's hands have, like, guns. They're like barrel fingers.
Well, I understand why that's not the case, because
the car... I also understand. I'm just saying I wish, but going over to Vega form, it's like I find it kind of dumb because of Deneb's big dumb barrel hands. Like when they become the shoulder pieces for like the cape or whatever, they become like the big shoulder pads. They look kind of bad. Like, they look kind of like they're just sitting there. They don't look like part of the outfit. They look like they're just there. Like, I can deal with the fake Deneb. Like, let me say one thing. This face on my chest isn't real. Like, the big dumb Deneb face on his chest doesn't really bother me, but it's that and the big dumb goofy hands on the shoulders that like... Or they're not really hands, but you know what I'm talking about. Like, the big dumb... Things on his shoulders.
Yeah.
They don't look good.
Because Deneb has finger guns.
Yeah.
And the barrels for the finger gun or for the finger guns are on the shoulders.
Yeah, and it just doesn't look like a part of the outfit. Everything else looks fine. And he's got the battle aura and it's really cool. And he's got all that good shit. And it's just like, yeah. Except for those shoulders, but yeah. It's
too bad they ran out of cards, because fucking Vega... Even though Vega form looks really dumb, it's the strongest one of them all.
Yeah, if you rank them in terms of power, it was probably Vega form, red form, zero form, and then base form.
Yeah.
All tiger form, I should say.
Yeah. And the same thing kind of translates over to...
Summer Triangle.
Whatchamacallit?
Deno.
Because
Climax form is the strongest.
Climax form is the strongest.
No. Climax wing form is the strongest.
Yeah, Climax wing form is the strongest, followed by Climax form, then
liner form. I would no.
Well, no, it's all the Imagines. Or all the other forms, then liner form, then the base form.
Yeah, it's like all right. Now we gotta settle this. Who's the like of the four base Imagine? How are they ranked in power?
In power, fucking Ryutaro's at the top. This is literally his introduction. Is he's the strongest of the base?
I don't know. Momotaro starts putting in that work. I think Momotaro gets up there.
All right.
Hold on. Let's start with this. Urataras is the bottom.
Yeah.
All right. He's not a fighter. He's a lover.
Yeah.
Starting there. All right. Now we have to rank Ryu, Kintaras, and Momo.
Okay. Battle wise, Ryutaros might be at the bottom because He doesn't have a power weapon.
He's got the gun.
Yeah.
And he's got rider shooting.
Yeah. Then it's a tie
between Kintaros and Momo.
Yeah, and Momotaros, because the whole point when they introduce Kintaros is that they're kind of like they're supposed to be an even match. One's got super defense, the other one's got super attack.
But like Kintaros is super strong still.
What Kintaros at the top then?
All right. Yeah. Okay. So it's like if we were talking, yeah, sheer combat ability, it's Kintaros. He does know karate.
Yeah.
And by which I mean sumo. Koi! Like he thinks, oh, this is karate. It's like Kintaros, where do you think karate is? Oh, it's where you stand with your feet apart and you doskoi. And it's just like that's
not karate.
That's not karate.
The kids laughing. The children laughing out of that's not karate.
That's sumo, and he's just like, my entire life is a lie. He's like looking existentially at his hands. My entire life is a lie.
Because literally his entire life was to master karate, which he didn't do.
Which he mastered sumo. Well, I mean, sumo is kind of a type of karate, because karate is just a martial... It's just a broad term for martial arts forms. And sumo is kind of that, a little bit. A little bit.
I don't have anything else. Got a score. That's it.
Oh, 7.5 out of 10. Maybe an 8. I don't know. Like I enjoyed it, but like I still have like all of those like they broke all these rules. They broke all these rules. Like I would say if it was
7 out of 10 because even as they were breaking rules, they immediately threw something at my face that I could just go like, oh, like, fuck that rule. This cool thing is in front of me.
Yeah. They jangled those keys. Yeah. Like, I would say the show
They jangled those keys very expertly. At least they had enough time to pass when they first introduced those rules to where it's like, wait, are they breaking a rule right now? Whatever, they just... those keys, though.
This really cool finisher. Hey, look, Stieg's back.
This plan is dumb and it makes no... Stieg!
Yeah, it's like, all right, I would say 7.5. If it wasn't for all of the blatant, like, rule breaking, like, when you go back and think about it, this show would probably be an 8 to 8.5 for me, but with all the rule breaking, I would give it a 7.5. Like, I very much enjoyed it. This was definitely a show where the enthusiasm of everyone shone through. Yeah. Like, even though I was super sketch on the owner, he definitely grew on me. Like, the owner was, like, super, like... I'm like
the entire beginning half of the show. Scott was like looked at me as if the owner was evil the whole time,
and then he starts like nunchucks with the spoons and dual wielding spoons and getting into rice eating competition.
Dude, when they opened the suitcase and it was filled with all the fancy fucking the golden spoons,
the golden spoons.
Oh man,
like I was getting into it. Like I was super getting into it.
This to me is the start of like all the Rider series that are like going forward are at least sevens. I think everything before this we had that whole flaccid. We had all the flaccid shows.
But now we're about to get rock hard. Oh, okay. So we might have to change up our scoring. Like we're gonna have to change the bar a little bit.
Hey, we're starting our nonstop infinite climaxes
from start to finish. We were always at climax. It's like yeah, the cast was really enjoyable. There was a lot of the only person like if you watch the show, everyone's putting in a lot of energy, except a little bit. And I only say this in everyone's giving like super huge like bombastic performances except for Ryotaro's character, but that's okay because Ryotaro's character is not a big bombastic personality, so he's like the straight man for all of like, you know, Momotaro's hamminess or the owner's like big dramatic speeches as he's fucking eating rice like a champion. Or yeah. Naomi's, yeah, let's do this. Or Hana's like just aggressive personality.
Her tsundere.
Her
aggressive tsundere.
Her aggressive tsundere-ness.
Oh, man.
And Yuto's fucking cock-lord.
Somebody had to be the straight man.
And it worked with Ryotaro being the straight man. Having the main character be the straight man. Because, like, what was really cool about him is, like, if you look at him in, like, conversations in the show, he's kind of, like, it's a really, like, minor thing, but it's, like, when you see him talking to people, he's kind of, like, swayed back as people are, like, using their big hammy personalities at him, and he's kind of swaying back.
He's like, a pushover, like, for most of the start of the show,
but even when he starts getting a spine, he's still soft-spoken, but he's, like... He's like the reed. He bends, but he does not break.
Yeah.
That's how I see Ryotaro, and that's an important character trait because it contrasts and also complements like the big stone pillars of the Imagine's personalities and stuff like that. In terms of like the serious moments, like obviously the train conductor and Naomi are like comedic characters. And they're there for, like, those comedic moments. But I'm talking, like, in the serious moments when we have Kai and his, like, mentally unhingedness. Or Yuto being a cock lord. Even though, you know, he's got a... All right, now I know he's got a good reason.
Yeah. He had a good reason, and he did change his attitude somewhat. Yeah, yeah.
So it's like when Yuto's being a fucking jerkass or his grandson's being a fucking jerkass, he's like the reed that bends but never breaks. As opposed to the stone pillars of the Imagine... that break and then rebuild. Yeah. Because there's all those times where the Imagine are just like, it's fine. Everyone's just like, oh no, we're worried you're going to disappear. He's like, and Momotaro's like, it's fucking sick of it. And he's like,
I don't care if I'm going to die. I want to fight like a badass.
Oh yeah, Momo does get that really like, there's that really good moment where it's like they're in the train station.
They're in the train station and then Momotaro's and Ryutaro are just fighting each other.
Oh man. It's a really, really good moment for Momotaro's because, like, Ryotaro is just like, oh, by fighting, I take away the Imagine's future, meaning you guys are going to go away. Like, I don't want to do that. And Momotaro's is just like, we already knew what we were getting into when we were going to help you stop the Imagine future or what. Or he basically says something to that effect. Yeah. I don't remember the exact line, but he basically says something to that effect. And Ryotaro is kind of like, I don't want to do it anymore. You guys are... I don't want you guys fighting anymore.
And then after a fight between each other, that's when they came up with, like... Well, Ryotaro's like, I have to do it regardless.
Yeah, yeah, it's just really good because it just shows how badass... That's like the Momo moment. The Momotaro's moment for me. It's just like when he's just like, I'm sick of hearing how we're going to vanish. I don't care. I made this decision. I knew what the consequences are.
Yeah, he's saying that also for the other guys.
Yeah, it's like they're all agreeing with him. They don't do it like as Momo because Momo's the fiery hothead of the group, but they're all like, yeah, we're basically with him.
Yeah.
And there was also that really good fight scene in the train station.
Yeah.
Where they've all got their weapons.
I don't have anything else to say.
Yeah, like the show's exciting. It's got some problems. It's got, you know, some problems if you really put your mind to it. But I feel like if you're going into it for like a good like exciting time, Deno is the nonstop infant. It's a climax from start to finish. It starts off strong and ends really strong. Yeah. So yeah, definitely good show. But next time we're gonna get fucking edgy. We're gonna get fucking edgy with Kamen Rider Kiva, and I can't wait.
Yeah.
So see you guys next time.